And that worked. So tonight we're going to begin a four-part series entitled The Bible, Economic Uncertainty, and Your Money. And my screen is showing, correct?
We don't see it right now.
Oh, you don't see my screen. Good. Let me make sure I have my exciting intro again. Here we go. Now you can see my screen.
Yes.
So now we're going to begin our little talk, The Bible, Economic Uncertainty, and Your Money. And this is going to be an interactive session, so you can feel free to unmute yourself at any point, ask me a question, and stop me. But we have an agenda for our time together. First of all, we're going to be here for 4 weeks, so I bet it'd be interesting. Otherwise, you have three miserable weeks to sit through. So first of all, we're going to talk about how money works in America. This is really going to be interesting. The second thing we're going to do next week is we're going to talk about offensive financial tools, tools that help you to get ahead and to stay ahead. And then, of course, we're going to also talk about defensive financial tools, tools to get you from behind if you are behind. And then we're going to end up on the fourth week with how to develop a financial plan in the midst of uncertainty. So if we're still together, let's the show begin. How money works in America. Now, if you didn't catch that, if you're at home, I'm going to try to take that back because that was pretty cool. So I think you should get every part of the experience. So let's do this one more time to make sure we get this. One more time, let the show begin. Isn't that cool? The way it kind of, that's my proof that I am the younger brother because I've yet to grow up. All right, so let's get serious. Let's talk about how money works in America. I have a sevenfold objective. So tonight we're going to first of all establish a scriptural foundation. We always go to the Bible first. I might be the younger brother, but I'm still in line with Pastor Harrison's ordination and stuff. Then we're going to talk about taxes. And I want you to pay attention to the order I'm rolling this out. After taxes, we're going to talk about the beginning of wealth. Where does wealth begin? And I'm glad my brother, Brother Marcus Harrison is on the line because he's going to be able to really verify what I'm saying about where the beginning of wealth begins. And he should know exactly what I'm talking about. After that, we're going to move to credit. And I'm doing it in a very systematic order. So pay attention to the order. Then we're going to define and we're going to look at uncertainty, what it is and why it is. Then we're going to look at our God. What does our God do with uncertainty? And if we have any time left, we're going to have some Q&A. So let's flip into the Bible. Now I'm going to read this scripture to you, and I want you to pay very close attention. This is familiar scripture, but I'm going to teach it to you, and I'm going to mention it to you in an unfamiliar way. Now, I'm not Pastor Jimmy, so I'm not going to try to be exactly scripturally exegeted accurately, but there's some things in this particular scripture that are going to set the scene for all 4 weeks. So let's read. Jesus told his disciples. Now, who's talking? Jesus is talking, right? We got it? Jesus is talking. These are the words of a parable of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Hold that in your mind because it's about to get really interesting. He says, there was a rich man whose manager was accused of wasting his possessions. So he called him in and asked, what is this I hear about you? Give an account of your management because you cannot be manager any longer. So here's a man who owns a business. One of his employees has been wasting his possessions, doing a bad job, and he's about to fire this manager. Are you still with me? So this manager is about to face economic uncertainty. Did you like that? The manager is about to face a personal pandemic. There are people that are going through personal pandemics. Let's keep reading. Verse 3. The manager said to himself, what shall I do now? My master has taken away my job. I'm not strong enough to dig, and I'm ashamed to beg. Or if you came up in the 80s, I'm too proud to beg. But we're not going to go back to the 80s, at least that's not part of the 80s. Now watch what he does. Let's flip over. He says, I know what I'll do so that when I lose my job here, people will welcome me into their houses. Isn't that interesting? Look what he says. He says, so he called each one of his master's debtors. Now, who's he calling? People who owed his boss money. And he asked the first, how much do you owe my master? And he says, 900 gallons of olive oil, he replied. The manager told him, take your bill, sit down quickly, and make it 450. I don't know if you can tell what's going on, but if you can tell what's going on, he's doing something dishonest. Hold that in your mind. And I told you, Jesus is telling this story. Then he says to the second, and how much do you owe? He said, 1,000 bushels of wheat, he replied. And he told him, take your bill and make it 800. Now we're gonna stop right here and we're gonna think about this. Here's a man getting fired from his job. And just before he gets terminated, he decides to defraud his manager, defraud the owner rather, and trick the man and have people change how much they owe so that they owe his boss less money, defrauding the boss. Now, I'm gonna put you in the story. You are now the boss. Can you tell me in your mind, don't say it out loud, this is a Christian thing and we're Christians, but what would you say about this man who just lied and defrauded? Let's flip and see what he says. The master, listen to this, the master commended the dishonest servant, the dishonest manager, because he had acted shrewdly. Now, is anybody else wondering how this made it into the Bible? My mother, who's on the call, brought me up not to lie and not to cheat. And mom, the Bible seemed to be telling me to lie and cheat. Now look what it says after this. It says, for the people of this world are more shrewd in their dealing with their own kind than the people of light. The King James Bible says it like this. It says, the children of this world are in their generation wiser than the children of light. Now, after having told this parable, Jesus is about to speak in verse 9. What do you think Jesus is going to say? Now, based on how I was raised Southern Baptist, I was raised in church, I would think the first thing Jesus would say is this man's a liar and he should be thrown into the pit of something really bad. I think he would say something like, I cannot believe somebody who's getting fired, whose character is that bad that they would lie. But look what Jesus said. I, Jesus, tell you, use your worldly wealth to gain friends for yourself so that when it is gone, you will be welcome into eternal dwellings. Let's think about this. This scripture is saying something very interesting. Remember, our subject tonight is the Bible, economic uncertainty, and your money. And tonight's subtitle is How Money Works in America. This manager understands how money worked in Israel. Are you with me? This man understood how to use worldly wealth to get ahead and to stay ahead. Jesus is not saying lie to get out of debt. I'm not going to tell you to do that. He's not going to tell you to trick people out of their money. It may make you rich, but the word of God is not going to allow that to happen. But let's keep reading. He says, whosoever can be trusted with very little can be trusted with very much. And whosoever is dishonest with very little will be dishonest with much. Thank God for Jesus. At least Jesus said the man was dishonest. Let's stop and thank God for a moment, because I was beginning to think that the Lord is going to lie and cheat, and I was afraid of him. I already fear God. Now you're going to lie on me. No, the Lord is not going to lie on you. But listen to this. We're going to get to where we're headed now. So if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, no, your Wi-Fi is doing fine. I'm saying it over and over for a reason. Who will trust you with true riches? I believe the church needs to be educated on how to handle worldly wealth. This world is not our home, but we may as well learn how to handle it, because this is how we get by here. And he says, and if you've not been trustworthy with someone else's property, who's going to give you your own property? And here's our main verse. No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You and I cannot serve both God and money. You got to pick one. And everybody on this call has chosen to serve God. And since you've chosen to serve God, God has sent you somebody to tell you, here's how to handle your money. Isn't God good? Unless I mess up, then I made God look bad. So let me not mess up. So let's take off with what we're going to talk about. Oh, I want to do that one more time. I really like that particular one. I just like that one. So let's go ahead and take off into what we're going to talk about. I have two key statements, and I want these statements are going to guide us for the rest of tonight, and it might guide us for the rest of our time together over the next 4 weeks. And if you're watching this live on recording, you want to tune in next week live because it's different when you see it live. But let's look at this first statement. The American financial system is not equitable. All men have been created equal, but the American financial system is not created equal. What do I mean by this? And I want you to listen to this very carefully. It's going to follow us. The American financial system rewards certain behaviors. There are certain things you do with your money, and in America, if you do these things, you will be rewarded. America's financial system punishes certain behaviors. So there's certain things that you do, America's financial system will punish you for doing it. It's not that you are wrong or that it is wrong. The American system, the financial system, will reward certain things and it will punish certain things. I'm getting excited because I know where we're going and I can't wait to tell you how this works out. But hold this in your mind, the American financial system is not equitable. Now, if you know you're going to get rewarded for moving to the left and you're going to get punished for moving to the right, how many people are still going to move to the right? Most of us, if we have half a brain, a little bit of Jesus, and a little bit of sense, we're going to try to move to the left where we can get rewarded. But how many know that the American system has most of us moving to the right to get punished, even though the system does reward certain behaviors? This is neither good or is it bad. I am not anti-America. This is not an anti-Trump meeting. This is not a pro-Trump meeting. This is not even a neutral Trump meeting. This is a meeting while Trump is president. That is about it. It's not a Democratic position. It's not a Republican position. It is not a pro-capitalist position. It's not an anti-capitalist position. I'm just telling you the truth. If you ask me my opinion, I'll give it to you, but nobody asked. So number two, statement number two that's going to guide us. The American financial system is a capitalist system. How many people didn't know that? Everybody knows that. We know it's a capitalist system. What we don't know is what does that mean concerning you and I and our money? Well, let me show you. This system is based on private ownership and making profits. Wow. Glenn Jackson has taught deep, deep things tonight. Everybody knows that. I would suggest that you don't know that. You've heard it before. You understand it, but you don't really know what that means. And tonight you're going to find out. The system is not based on communism, which would be a publicly controlled or a unified system. It is based on private ownership and making profits. So let's put our two statements together. Some Americans have privately owned things and been rewarded for their behavior, so they're on top. Most of Americans have not done the capitalist thing, and we're being punished for those behaviors, and we're on the bottom. America hired you, if you are working, to make a profit off of you, because the system is based on what? Private ownership and making profits. If it is profitable, America will reward you. You will keep your job. If you're not profitable, America will punish you. So if you have a job and you're not on the revenue producing side of that job and there are layoffs, they're coming for you. They're coming to take you away. Kind of the same way they should come and take me away because I'm a bit of a comedian. The system of this world, listen to this, this is so important. It functions on two things, consumer spending and debt. During this pandemic, the United States government decided, that wasn't supposed to happen yet. Let me go back, going the wrong way. In America, during this pandemic, the United States government that was in nearly $1 trillion of debt did a law where they cut checks for $2 trillion. If we were communists, that would not have happened. If we were another type of government, that would not have happened. Why did they do that? Because the system functions on consumer spending. If consumers don't spend, we're all out of here. It also functions on debt. If people are not in debt, we're all out of here. Just stay with me. So let's get to our second subtitle, understanding taxes in America. Understanding taxes in America. Now let me break it down for you. Oh, did you see the breakdown? I like that. I'm gonna do that one more time. Let me just break it down for you. If you're not laughing, I'm laughing at myself. I can enjoy my own self. Now listen to this statement. It says, for most, taxes consume more of our income than food, shelter, and clothing combined. I told you to watch the order I was going to roll this out in. So I told you how the American, first of all, I took you through the scripture. Then I told you how the American financial system works. And what's the next thing I'm going to take? I'm going to take the biggest amount of money that you spend, and I'm going to deal with the first. So how many know where I'm going to go for number two? The second thing I'm going to cover is the second biggest thing that occupies your money. So I'm dealing with taxes first because taxes take up too much money. Everybody knows this, but let's see if you really know it. There are two ways to do taxes: itemized deduction or standard deduction. I told you that America rewards some behaviors and punishes other behaviors. President Trump passed a law that increased the standard deduction for unmarried people to $12,400. For married people, just multiply by two, is $24,800. Now watch this. Oh, I don't want to get to that yet. If you are using the standard deduction, America does not reward you. It just gives you that. If you are using itemized deductions, America does reward that, because the American financial system, let's remember, it rewards some things and it punishes other things. It does not mean that if you're using the itemized deduction, you're better, or if you're using the standard deduction, you're bad or you're worse. We are children of the Most High God. There are two types of people that are going to heaven and people that are not. And you're going to heaven, and all these people that are itemized deductions, they're not. So, unless you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, this is something that few of us really know. American tax brackets are progressive. What does that mean? What does it mean when I say that American tax brackets are progressive? It means something very simple. The more you make, the more they take. So the more you make, the more they take. However, it's deeper than that. I said it was progressive. So let me show it to you. Let's take a look. Let's uncover the American tax system. These are the 2020 tax brackets. Here's what many people don't know. Most people that look at this think, if I make, I'm looking for the little notation things. Let me see if I can get a notation. I'm going to get fancy on you all, and I'm going to use some fancy stuff. Give me 1 second. I'm going to notate and spotlight. So here we go. So most people believe that if you make $200,000 to $500,000 a year here, with these numbers, you pay 35% of income taxes. How many believe that? Don't raise your hands, but raise it in your heart. If your hand is up, you're wrong. Whoa, let me put my hand down, because I'm wrong. In America, if you make $207,000, on the first $19,750 that you own, that you pay, if you're unmarried, let's just deal with the unmarried. The first $9,800, $75, you only pay 10% on that. The next batch of money that you make between $98.76 and $41.25, you pay 12% on that, and so on and so forth. It is progressive. So the more you make, the more they take of your income. That's very important, because some of us think, I don't want to get into the wrong tax bracket. Different monies that you have can end up being taxed different ways based on how you made that money. Oh, we might be getting deep now. I'm trying to keep it shallow because this is week one and I have three more weeks to get really deep. But I want you to understand this. As you progress through the tax system, the amount of money they take is a greater percentage. So if you are on the wealthy side and you make $518,000 or more, give me a call after the meeting. I'd love to meet with you. I can invest your money. We can make a lot of money together. Let's get together and let's have a good time. And if you know anybody that makes that kind of money, help a brother out. send me the referral. I can make them money. I'll make you money, and we'll all be happy together, and I'll take care of you too. But very, very important, people who are in a 37% tax bracket, now realize this is only federal. When you add state taxes and local taxes to this, if you make $500,000, the government takes more than half. How many knew that? So wealthy people want to do everything they can to reduce the amount of money that they make in terms of what is taxable. So they looked at the tax laws to see what can I do to be rewarded and what do I need to avoid to be punished? Are we still together? Amen. I knew I'm doing it like a sermon. I'm not allowing a lot of time for interaction, but I want to get this thing founded pretty tightly. And I think I want to get that done. So let me go on to my next slide, try to figure out what just happened. Okay, so let's uncover something new. Tax rates, again, they differ based on how much money you make. But capital gains are taxed completely differently. And there's a misspelling, D-F-F-E-R-E-N-T-L-Y. So Letterman needs to come in and rescue. Anybody know Letterman? Let him fly in and give me an R. So capital gains are different, are taxed not differently, but differently. Long-term capital gains are not taxed if you make $40,000 or less. Stop and think about that. Now start to sound like the shrewd manager in the earlier part of our lesson. So if you have a short-term capital gain, you pay normal income tax. If you have a long-term capital gain, you're not even taxed on the first $40,000. But wait, what is a capital gain? I'm glad you asked that question. You didn't have to mute. I'm a man of prayer. I asked God, and God told me, these people don't know what you're talking about. You need to tell them what a capital gain is. A capital gain, watch this, is the amount of money you make for selling an investment. So if you sell an investment and you've held it for more than 1 year, it's considered a long-term capital gain. If you sell it within a year, it's considered a short-term capital gain. So a long-term capital gain, if I invest my money, if I make my money and invest it, I can make a big profit and not pay taxes if I'm making $40,000 or less. If I make up to $441,000, I can only pay 15%. Very quickly, let's go back to our tax brackets. Look where the 15% tax bracket is. It's way down here around making $40,000 a year. That's a 12% tax bracket. So what do the wealthy do? They invest their money and they pay taxes like they don't make a lot of money, and they're making a lot. But if they make over $441,500, the maximum long-term capital gain is 20%. Let's slip backwards to our tax brackets. So that's like you made $85,000 a year. So millionaires who should be being taxed at 37% put their money in places, have their money work for them, and they only pay 20%. And that's just on their investments. When we get to real estate, they do even better on real estate. And my brother knows that you can make some money buying and selling properties, and you can reduce the taxes tremendously on real estate. That's the reason why they own it. There were once tax brackets of being married, but they are rapidly decreasing. Why am I saying this? Because I'm talking to the church, right? This is Cresthill Church, right? If I said this outside of the church, they don't get it. Why do you think the tax brackets are changing and you don't get a benefit for being married? Look at what the world is doing to the definition of marriage. America rewards behaviors that benefits them. Being married used to get you great tax benefits. They don't respect marriage, so they're taking away the tax benefit to disincentivize people to get married. There's an old show called Good Times. And on Good Times, there was an episode where the parents of the main characters, James Evans, came in. And they were shacking. And James' wife, Florida, said, "Y'all can't be shacking. You're grandparents." And the actor playing the father said, "The government taxes us differently because we're not married." And they realized that if they were to get married, it would hurt them financially. Since that was recorded in the early 70s, the tax brackets got better for married people to encourage marriage. But guess what's happened over the last 4 years? This is not a Trump statement. It actually started 8 years ago. The tax benefits, because of the gay rights movement, changed because they felt discriminated against because they were not allowed to get married. So they destroyed the tax benefits and those laws came into place. Then gay marriage became legal, but marriage has been attacked. This thing is really interesting. You got to pay attention to how the world works. So there was a benefit. What does this tell to our young people? Our young people are living together and not getting married, which is a sin, at an alarming rate because they are no longer incentivized. And there's nothing like telling the person, you know, if you get married, you can save some money. It'd be amazing how many people would fall in love. I'm not saying that's why I fell in love, but I did take advantage of the opportunity. Mama didn't raise no fool. So let's take a look at this. Those of you who are able to do tax write-offs, the government and the financial system rewards you. So let's look at some examples of tax write-offs. Tithes, offerings, and alms. I put every way to give to the church I could think of. Pastor Harrison, okay, if you can think of another way to give to the church, I wanted to put that first. The government rewards you giving to the church. Why would they do that? Because the body of Christ is supposed to do good works. And Cresthill Church is one of those churches that does good works. You all participate in the food bank. You have concerts to raise money for those who are hungry. You reach out to people who are toe up from the flow up. That's, I even put a flow in the slide. And you started at the flow and took them from the flow right on up. That is something the government wants every church to do. Every church is not a Cresthill Church, but every church should be like Cresthill, at least in that area, and help out the poor. Your mortgage and your interest and your mortgage taxes are also tax write-offs. What is a tax write-off? I heard somebody just ask that question. I picked it up in the spirit. Okay, maybe I didn't pick it up in the spirit. Maybe I just looked at my notes. But either way, I got it. A tax write-off means that whatever money you made to pay that, you don't have to pay taxes on the income you earn to do that. So the rich take all of their income and they give to number three, charitable giving. It's not because they love people, it's because they get a big tax write-off. You know, you can take clothes and give them to a clothing bank. You can write that off. Anything you give for charitable giving is tax deductible. The shirt that I'm wearing, it may have cost me $19.95. I wear it, you know, 85 times. It starts to smell. It starts to look crazy. Do you know I am allowed to put it in that basket, give it away, and claim that it's worth $10? Even though it might be worth $2, because the tax law reward giving in a lenient manner. They will give, I actually turned in a car that couldn't run at all, and they let me write off $2,000. I said, the car doesn't work. It was in a car accident. Doesn't matter. They just want to encourage you to give. Get on the right side. Health insurance premiums, I think they just have mercy. That just costs too much. Child care, that's tax deductible. So if you're not writing off your child care, write it off. That includes babysitting. So if you babysit and you have your parent babysit, next time you give them something, say, listen, this was for the babysitting, and write it off. Business expenses are tax deductible, including your home. So business owners have a tax advantage. So America rewards you for being a business owner, not for watching Shark Tank, but for taking an offer from a shark. Because if you are a business owner, which I am, you get a tremendous tax benefit. I am getting a benefit on the Wi-Fi that I use right now. Why? Because I need Wi-Fi to operate my business. The government doesn't even tell me I can't use it. They say, go ahead and use your own Wi-Fi. Don't use your neighbor's. That's not only illegal, that's not even Christian. Use your own Wi-Fi, but if it's for your business, write it off. So if you can have a home business and you are a homeowner, the government says, you don't even have to make money in the first 5 years. Just try. And you can write off expenses. I can write off a portion of my mortgage. I can write off a portion of my gas and electric. I can write off a portion of my water bill. I wish I could write off a portion of my food because I love to eat and so does my son. And I could probably write off $10,000 a year on what we eat, but they don't allow me to do that. If I pay somebody to cut my grass, that's tax deductible because I have a home office and I have another office. Expenses related to rental properties. Why do you think people buy properties and rent them out? Because you can write it off. So let's get, we're done with taxes. Let's move to the next thing, the cornerstone of American wealth. What is the cornerstone of wealth in America? I'm glad you asked. Let's break it down. It's home ownership. I was watching the founder of VeggieTales just before I got on here. That's not the reason why I was late. I was late because I couldn't find the link to click on. But I was watching the founders of VeggieTales, and he was talking about home ownership, and he was talking about it as it relates to race relations. And he has some interesting statistics that are fresh in my mind, but I already have my slides together before this. But I want to talk about why home ownership is so important. Why is home ownership the corner of wealth in America? I'm going to prove it to you. First of all, after taxes, a mortgage or rent payment is usually the next largest expense that we have. So why do we deal with taxes first? That's your biggest bill. But number two, we're dealing with home ownership. Why? That's your second largest bill. So I'm going to go in a very logical order. Are we still together? America rewards homeowners and it punishes renters. It does not mean, again, that if you are a renter, you are a bad person. In fact, whoever you're renting for believes you're a good person and you're a blessing, especially if you pay your rent on time. I know my brother can say amen to that because he can fix up houses and rent them out, and nothing is worse than when people don't pay their rent. But home ownership is rewarded and renter is punished. Again, not bad or good, but it's what the American system does. Home ownership, again, homeowners do not pay taxes on the interest or the property that they tax that they pay. But why is home ownership the cornerstone of wealth? It has a measurable impact on one's wealth. Well, Glenn Jackson, how do you know that it has a measurable impact on one's wealth? Well, because I measured it, that's why. Let's look at the measurement. These numbers are from 2016, but the average net of a family that owned their home was $231,400. Let's do the prices right. Would anybody want to guess what the average net worth is of somebody that rents? $5,200. So homeowners on average have a net worth of $231,400. A lot of that is home equity. And renters, by contrast, on average, some of you renters are high rollers. High rollers still rent, but on average, renters have only $5,200. And it's not the renter's fault. The system has set it up to stop you from getting wealth. It sure has. Now I'm gonna do something, and I know these are racially tense times, but I'm gonna go there anyway. And I'm gonna show you home ownership by race and by ethnicity. Because I'm gonna use this to point out something that is very, very interesting and important. This red line down here, these are Black people. So here's the home ownership rates for the African American. The next line that's green is for Hispanics. Now, I didn't make this graph, so don't blame me that Blacks were red and don't start a race riot. How did you make the Hispanics green? It has nothing to do with anything. That's how they did it. So here's the Hispanic rate. You'll notice that over the 2000, Hispanic home ownership has gone up above African-American home ownership, but both of them have begun to go down in recent years. The next line I'm gonna draw attention to is this top line, which is the non-Hispanic white. And you notice that the home ownership rate is much higher amongst that particular demographic than all other races together are this orange line in the middle. And that line is higher than the African-American and Latino. So this is just the facts on home ownership. Let's take a look at wealth. Look at the racial gap with wealth. Blacks at the bottom, then Hispanics, then Asians, which dominate that other graph, and then there's white. So I wanna go back and I wanna show this to you. Home ownership, wealth. Home ownership, wealth. Can you see the relationship? There is a clear demarcation between whether or not you own your home and where your wealth is going to be. Now, I divided it by race. However, there are many African Americans that own their home. And guess what happens to an African American that owns their home on this graph? I don't have a graph for that, but the African American that owns their home has an average net worth that looks like the Asian on this map. Because home ownership, if you move out of home from renting to home ownership, you automatically go up the scale. It is a tremendous relationship between the two. And it is by design. Now let me go back and quote my man from VeggieTales. The founder of VeggieTales just told me on a YouTube video that from 1932 to 1970, the government said that it was illegal to sell certain homes to African Americans. And if you were a realtor and you were caught doing it, you could lose your license and your job. So back then, not today, but back then, there was a very direct, overt racial attack on who could own a home. So the fact that these statistics look like they do today were probably predicated on things that happened later on. That's why I'm glad I was born in 1970, so that I could be a part of the moving on up generation like the Jeffersons and not be staying on down like the Sanford and Son. But that blew me away when I learned that. I want that joke back one more time because I like that one. That just blew me away. I like that one. America rewards home ownership and it's made it the cornerstone of the American dream. At the same time, it makes it difficult to move from renting to owning. You know why? Because if everybody owns, the American financial system will collapse. There must be renters for us to be able to operate. The American system, like I said in the beginning, is not equitable. It's designed for some to be on top and others to be on the bottom. Now, next week, I may actually invite a special guest in to help us if we're trying to learn how to own a home or refinance. And since some of you are going to watch this later on, I'm going to have his contact information if he's not with me, because I'm going to have him explain how you can move from renter to owner to get yourself out of this rat race and get yourself on top. But home ownership is the most common way to pass down wealth and create financial security. That's why my mother and your mother should make sure that they own their house. Because my mother and your mother were hanging up clothes. And my mother, I'm sorry, I'm going back to old nursery rhyme. And I went back. My mother popped your mother right dead in the nose. What color was the blood? The blood was red, white, and blue. And if they owned a home, that home is for you. Amen. Now, don't forget our key statements. It rewards certain behaviors. It punishes other behaviors. And housing of the past is still impacting the present. But Jesus is not America, or is Jesus American? Jesus is not saying he doesn't love you if you don't own a home. He's not saying he loves you if you do own a home. He's saying the American system will reward you financially because it'll give you some options if you own a home. Let's move to credit. And believe me, I'm closer to done than you think. So let's take off with credit. I want to run through this rather quickly because we're going to deal deeply with credit in week number 3. Everybody needs credit. I need credit. You need credit. All God's children need credit. And children of the devil need credit too. So I'm going to go ahead and get them credit, even though they're going to the lake of fire. They still need credit because we might be able to get them saved. And if Cresthill has anything to do with it, if my church has anything to do with it, they'll give them credit because we want them saved. Beginning at age 18, you can and you should get credit. But credit or debt begins with your credit score. Your credit score impacts how much you pay. So if you have a low credit score, you pay more for the same item. If you have a low credit score, you pay more for the same item. Glenn Jackson, that's not fair. I agree with you wholeheartedly. That's why I came by. Or as your pastor says, I stopped by to tell you. Well, I didn't stop by to tell you because I didn't come over. I'm sitting here to tell you that what you do can be rewarded if you do the right thing. And if your credit score is low, you will pay more. So two people go out to buy a car, a Toyota Camry. The person with a 700 or better credit score pays $350 a month. A person that has a 550 to 700 pays $500 a month. I'm sorry, the first person pays $400 a month. The next person pays $500 a month. And if you're below 550, you're going to pay $600 a month for the exact same car. So those who can least afford it pay the most. Why? because the children of this world are in the generation wiser than the children of light. And in order for the system to work, those at the bottom must bear the burden so those at the top can stay there. So what you need to do is learn how to get your credit score up. And I'm going to teach you that in week three. Don't skip week two, because week two, I'm going to help you get ahead. But week three, I'm going to show you how to get your credit score up. But you must be aware of and protect your credit score. It will change your financial life. What is your credit score made up of? Number one thing you need to look at is 35% of it is made up of payment history. What does that mean? It means something very simple. Pay your bills on time. If you cannot pay a bill on time, I don't care how small it is, call the creditor and talk to them. Do not pay your bills late under any circumstances. It's the number one thing to affect your credit score. What about number two? I'm going to deal with number two in week number three. That's all you get tonight. I'm going to get you to come back next time. There's a such thing as good debt, and there's a such thing as bad debt. Good debt is when you buy things that usually increase in value, like a house. Why did I say usually? Because sometimes you can buy a house, and it can be a housing bubble, and your house goes down in value. I bought my house 12 years ago for more than what it's worth today. Everybody say, oh, I want you to feel bad for me. I want sympathy. I do want to be a blessing to you, but I want a moment for everybody to take a moment and feel bad for me. All right, no more feeling bad for me. I wanted my moment. Credit card debt compounds, causing your balance to grow rapidly. We're going to deal with that again more in week three. But that's something you know, but I wanted to put it out there for you. Debt in America is not set up for you to ever get out. It's designed to keep you there. We're going to talk about how it's designed to keep you there, and we're also going to talk about how to get around it. I have answers. You have questions? I have answers. Come back in week three. But America relies on debt from its citizens as well as itself in order to get ahead. America is 100% reliant on debt. In fact, debt is now an international phenomenon. America is one of about 80 developed nations that are operating in a deficit. It's global now. It's all over the world. But before I take up too much time, let me take you back to another connecting statement from the beginning. Remember, the American financial system is a capitalist system based on private ownership, based on consumer spending. Keep that in mind. Let's talk about economic uncertainty, because I want to wind up and see if there are any questions. America, the American economy is always going through cycles, cycles of economic expansion and cycles of economic contraction. It always does that. So there are times when people who don't understand money jump into a market during an economic expansion. A lot of people over the last 10 years jumped into real estate. Why? Because interest rates went low and the economy expanded. Then the housing market burst, and those who jumped, I'm sorry, I'm going back 20 years. 20 years ago, people jumped into real estate. 10 years ago, there was a market bubble that burst. So everybody became underwater in their homes, not understanding what happened. It's because there's always a cycle. So if somebody's trying to tell you about doing something financially, understand there's a cycle. And they may be duping you because they don't even know that there's a cycle, and you're jumping into a cycle that's going to blow up under your feet. And occasionally, a national or international event disrupt those cycles. Wars and rumors of wars, political and social events, and global pandemics. So we actually just had a situation, and we're in the midst of a situation that is disrupting those cycles. We're going to deal with that more at another time. But this current pandemic is not unique. A pandemic happened about 100 years ago like this. They're very difficult to predict, and they're very difficult to prepare for, but God's word does not change during a pandemic. 7 years of famine in Egypt, God's word took care of them. Various famines and plagues that happened in the Bible, God's word took care of them. This is new to us, but this is not new to our God. And in weeks to come, I'm going to show you from the scripture how to prepare yourself for an economic pandemic, what to do when you're in a economic pandemic, and what God does while you're in an economic pandemic like we're in. But the key that I want you to know tonight, this is just about my ending, I think it is I want you to focus on your financial position during the crisis. And if you're not in the right position, I want your sole focus to be reposition yourself. I taught something at my church called Preparing Yourself for Financial Flood. And I'm going to conclude with this story. I asked the congregation, I said, if you knew a flood was going to come into this room, when it was going to flood from the back, where would you sit? And everybody said, we would sit up front. I said, if you knew that a flood was going to come up to just above the chairs, what would you do? They said, we would stand on the chairs. They said, if you knew a flood was coming an hour from now, what would you do? How many would stay in the room? Everybody said, I would leave. I said, in all three positions, if you knew what was coming, you would do what? Reposition yourself based on what is coming. I showed you how America worked. I'm going to tell you in weeks to come what's coming. I want you to listen to what I'm saying and focus on getting yourself out of harm's way. The answer to this entire thing, the Bible, economic uncertainty, and your money is for you to reposition yourself so that when these things happen, you are in a safe place in perilous times. My time is up. I thank you for yours. That's my pastor's jingle. Are there any questions? Because I did all the talking tonight. I felt like preaching.